College of Agriculture, and it is my sincere pleasure to welcome you to our 22nd College of Agriculture graduation ceremony. This is always an exciting and fun event because we are here to cheer, applaud, and to honor the class of 2009. Thank you for joining us. At this time, I would like to introduce to you the Dean of the College of Agriculture, Dr. Frank Gailey, who will introduce our stage party, offer some remarks, and introduce our commencement speaker.
On behalf of the College of Agriculture, good afternoon and welcome. Thank you for joining us to celebrate success, students, faculty, and families. I would like to begin by thanking Associate Dean Wangberg and his staff for doing a wonderful job of putting this all together this afternoon. I would also like to welcome our stage party. Joining us today are Rachel Watson, one of the college's most outstanding teachers. Dr. Steve Miller, Associate Dean and Director of the Experiment Station. Dr. Myron Allen, Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs at the University of Miami. Dr. Danielle Peck, Assistant Professor with Ag and Applied Economics, and she's representing the Hauck School of Environment and Natural Resources. We also have with us Associate Vice President for Administration, Mark Collins. We're honored to have several of the University of Wyoming's leadership trustees with us today, beginning with UW trustee Dr. Taylor Haynes from Cheyenne. Mr. Jim Nyman from Hewlett, Wyoming. Dr. Howard Wilson from Thermopolis, Wyoming. And Rochelle from Casper. Thank you all for joining us today. Well, with apologies in style to University of Wyoming President Buchanan and David Letterman, I thought I'd have to come up with 10 things you really only learn in college. Number 10, asleep by 2:30 is an early night. Number 9, new additions to the food groups. Nutrition faculty help me with this. Mountain Dew, Doritos, Ben and Jerry's, Ho-Ho's, and Oreos. Number 8, recycling is synonymous with laundry. Oh, my jeans can last till Christmas. There's just a little bit of them. Keys have never been so important. At number 7, yet you seem to lose them more than ever before. Number 6, you meet the type of people you only thought existed in the movies when you're in college. Number 5 thing you learn only in college, you begin to realize that college is the ideal lifestyle except for those pesky classes. Number 4, you get good at rationalizing on whether to do homework or not. Usually not. Number 3, don't burn bridges, especially if your partner is good at biology, chemistry, or physics. Number 2, you just don't learn last names. And the number 1 thing you only learn in college, duct tape heals all wounds. And if not, scotch or masking tape will have to suffice. Anyway, to the students, faculty, and families who are here today, congratulations. This is your day. This moment for each student and your family marks a significant milestone. The diploma you are about to receive and you've earned recognizes many recent achievements. More importantly, though, this diploma is a license to learn. Learning begins at home with parents and caregivers, then grade in high school. For many, formal training leads to college or vocational school. For some, graduate professional schools. However, regardless of your path, the ability to acquire new knowledge must be a lifelong quest. Malcolm Forbes remarked that education's purpose is to replace an empty mind with an open one. The University of Wyoming has, as one of its many motivations, programs that stimulate the thirst for learning. And that lifelong learning is what we are all about. Youth, teaching, community, research and outreach are just parts of a bigger university mission. The university is not just a trade school. We'd be negligent if we took that approach. We must focus on the need to help people keep minds not only filled with facts, but open and able to analyze new ideas and concepts. We have animal science graduates who are successful bankers, ag business graduates who are successful attorneys. One alumna with an advanced degree in the college ended up founding a couple of important new biopharmaceutical companies. These individuals all point to learning skills, thirst for new ideas, and ability to learn as the key attributes picked up during their time at UW. Lifelong learning is augmented by leadership, and much has been written about leadership. It is characterized by strong people skills, the ability to recognize and address an issue larger than yourself, and motivating others to do the same. I've been privileged to watch our most recent graduates leading changes that make society better. I hope many of you have taken advantage of leadership opportunities on campus. Students lead and take part in activities as diverse as development of a community garden, taking groups on adventures in the outdoors, and making the campus community more green. Lifelong learning and leadership will be critical to you as you address the challenges facing the world today. It will be up to you to adapt, innovate, lead, and solve issues. An exciting challenge, but it won't always be easy. As Winston Churchill said, success is not final, failure is not fatal. It's the courage to get up and continue that counts. You now have the tools to do the right thing, learn, lead, and persist in your endeavors. Good luck. And now, I will heed Franklin Roosevelt's advice about speaking. His advice was be sincere, be brief, and be seated. So I'll close. Please stay in touch with us, graduates. Let us know how you're doing. We want to share in your successes. Enjoy your afternoon, and again, congratulations to our newest UW alums. And now it is a real privilege for me to be able to introduce one of the most outstanding teachers I've encountered. I've encountered a lot of outstanding teachers in my career. But we're very honored at the University of Wyoming College of Agriculture to have Rachel Watson on our faculty. Rachel teaches microbiology. She teaches about life. She's an amazing coach. She helps co-coach one of the nation and world's top Nordic ski teams. She just does it all. She did her undergraduate work at the University of Denver, did some graduate work here, got a master's at UW, and she's now working on her doctorate. And it is my privilege now to present to you Rachel Watson.
Wow. I am so honored and excited to be here today to talk with all of you graduates, your families, your mentors, and all of your friends. And speaking of friends, when Jim Weinberg invited me down to his office a few weeks ago, and he asked me if I would consider being the commencement speaker, I didn't tell him about my nightmare. Yeah, I have a reoccurring nightmare at least once every semester that I'm trying to give a microbiology lecture in the Arena Auditorium. And there are literally thousands of people there. Amazing opportunity. However, my sound system goes out. Yeah. And so, as the graduates will attest, one would think with my ridiculously powerful vocal cords, everything would be just fine. But in fact, in my dream, I yell and I yell and I just keep yelling, and people in the back are gesturing at me and telling me, you know, I can't hear, I can't hear. Thought, I realized that the only way around this is to literally bound from one region of the Arena Auditorium to the next until finally I've given each little portion of the lecture to every seating section in the whole Arena Auditorium. Yeah. brothers and sisters. And so in an environment like that, words like control, silence, neat and tidy, those were not words that we ever even thought about. Naturally, my love of an environment like that waxed and waned depending upon the day. But it was ever strengthened by the amazing young people who had a profound effect on me. There was Becca. For her birthday, Becca had gotten a new swimsuit. And she wore this swimsuit literally everywhere, which is saying a lot considering that I grew up in Leadville, Colorado at 10,152 feet. She would wear this swimsuit everywhere. And so finally, on the warmest summer day, I think it had climbed up to like 70 degrees, we decided to bust out the swimming pool, you know, the little plastic one, and to lead all the daycare kids out to the little plastic pool. And when I got the last little one ready to go, I followed her out the door and looked up, and there was Becca. Stark naked as a jaybird. So I went up to Becca and I said, "Becca, where's your swimsuit?" And she just looked at me as though it was completely obvious. "It's brand new. I didn't want to get him wet." Yeah. It was in the daycare that I've had my very first opportunities to teach. And I'm guessing that you graduates and many of you parents have had the opportunity to work with a young person who likes to ask why incessantly to everything you say. So there was Troy, and Troy really liked to ask why. "Why do we have to wash our hands?" I would always start with the simple answer first in hopes that that would suffice. "Because we want to get them clean." "But why do we want to get them clean?" Well, I'd step things up a notch, like really proud of my fifth grade education at this point, and I'd say, "Because there might be bacteria and viruses on your hand that could make you sick." "But why do bacteria and viruses make us sick?" Inevitably, my education at the time would fail me, and I would have to say something like, "Because I said so." It was also in the daycare that a young person first profoundly impacted me. There was Eric. Eric loved rainbows, piggyback rides. He loved to blow dandelions into the wind. Wise beyond his years, he would finish all of my mom's sentences, and he would talk to me about spirituality and love. When Eric was only two, he was diagnosed with leukemia, a disease against which he waged a battle for 4 years. The battle lost. I found very little will to go on. All I wanted to do was to go with him so that I could take care of him. The strength that I found to go on, to continue, was rooted in my need for vengeance against the cancer that had taken his life. And so, as a sophomore in high school, I donned my armor. It was a thick, shiny plate mail that clinked when I walked, and it shined in the sun. No, it wasn't plate mail at all. Actually, it was the really sexy leather stuff that they wear in Xena Warrior Princess, you know? Yeah, that was what it was. And I got my blinders. I had these great leather blinders. They're very much like the ones that the draft horses wear in downtown Denver when they're forced to focus only on the road ahead of them. And I cinched those tight and got those set to go. I desired nothing more than to be as brave as I thought Eric had been. Battle for revenge metastasized in my heart and my soul and my mind. And I jumped into the engineer seat of a train on a straight track to a career in medical research. I moved the brake to the release position, and through a hiss of air, I yelled back behind me and I said, much as all of you are going to do today, I realized that somehow my blinders had begun to loosen. You know, they were leather, so after that many years, it started to stretch a little, and they kind of started falling around my cheeks and rubbing against my ears a little bit. And to each side of the train, though I tried to fight it, I saw the beautiful scenery. There were gently falling dendritic snowflakes, ice-covered streams, and the many awards and honors that I had earned as a graduate. The outstanding senior chemistry major, they sat heavy on my lap. And I felt hollow, and I felt lonely. And all my body started to scream at me, "How, Rachel, how can you pursue such an impersonal career to avenge the death of someone who affected you so very personally?" And for the first time in 7 years, I turned around and there was society, now doggedly piling coal on my fires. Rippling muscles were now pooling with sweat. Curly hair was wet and matted over the brow of eyes half crazed. And our eyes met, and for a moment there came a disapproving stare. And just in that time, as our eyes were locked, I watched as the fires began to spit a little and dim. And I jumped. I jumped off the train, and my fall was padded by huge snowdrifts on either side of me. And as I stood there in the silence, watching the train speed away, I looked around and I was shocked. There were some others standing around me. And I began to realize that somehow the importance of my goal had obscured my own need to truly love what I was doing, to truly enjoy my career. And deep inside, I felt the knowledge that it was not my desire to fight against cancer that had gone away, but that I realized that I wouldn't be the one to do it from the engineer seat. And so I threw my blinders down onto the railroad tracks, and I forever diverted my gaze to the scenery around me. I didn't get rid of the Xena warrior armor. I kept that. I'm wearing it under my suit. And although my spouse would say to me with beautiful, honest eyes, years earlier, "Rachel, isn't it obvious that you're a teacher?" It would take me years to discover that on my own. So I strapped on my cross-country skis, and I began another journey. This one was slow. Through snowdrifts, across frozen lakes, and finally up mountains. And the clarity that came to me at the top of these snow-covered peaks allowed me to realize that I had made it there by fanning the flames of my own fire. And slowly, as I forgot the disapproving stare of the society that I had constructed, I began to give myself permission to truly value that which I loved. And that which I loved was teaching. Once in the classroom, I knew that I was in the right place, because just as I had almost 20 years earlier, I began to be impacted every day by young people. There was Josh. Josh was brilliant and tenacious. He loved to play with the Bunsen burners in lab. And so every time I gave a lecture, he would turn the Bunsen burner on sort of secretively, and he'd try to see if he could get the flames to jump up and hit the ceiling. One time Josh made a bet with his friends that he could get the high score on the exam, and he lost. So in front of hundreds of students in my lecture class, he got up and complete with his handle and his spout, he sang, "I'm a Little Teapot." It was in the classroom that I fell in love about the nuances of heterocyst development within the trichomes of cyanobacteria. At the same time, he reaffirmed my desire to pursue a teaching career. He helped me to rekindle my own passion for learning. There was Ashley, now a chemical engineer and a friend, and still the only person that I could talk to for hours about the parallels between society and promiscuous enzymes. It was in the classroom that, again, I was profoundly affected by young people. There was Greg. After having already earned degrees in philosophy and theology, Greg had taken a mandatory year-long break, during which he would decide whether he would return for a final year of schooling to be ordained as a priest. In this interim, he came to the University of Wyoming to pursue another love, that for science. Greg and I became fast friends, speaking over coffee and about science and religion, education and humanism. Through our shared words, we realized that in the end, what defines us is truly our motivation. These conversations continued in the classroom and at the coffee shop, and finally via email, when Greg made his choice to pursue a career in science. Throughout this last year, his emails came to me from the National Institutes of Health, where he had been working in medical research, specializing in lymphatic diseases in children. To this day, I will never know how it was that I was so honored to be a part of his journey. But I do know that I may have been one of the fortunate few that stood there when Greg plummeted off of his speeding train. Only weeks ago, during a particularly chaotic day in the lab, just as I like them, I received the most recent email from Greg. In his email, he shared with me the difficulty that he had faced in selecting the right medical school, one that would foster both his clinical and research ambitions. And though I have been communicating with Greg regularly for years, I was suddenly struck by the impact of his journey on me. I felt myself grow faint, and I literally sunk down into my chair. In his slow journey over hills, across streams, and up mountains, Greg had found his way to a career in medical research. The ripples hit me like waves and literally knocked me to my feet. And I felt them pass from Eric through me and to Greg. From Becca through Troy, from Eric to me, through Josh and Ashley, from Chase to me to Greg. So graduates, I leave you with this. As you journey through life, fan the fires of your own flames. And remember to always let people affect you in profound ways. Make your journey slowly, and when you find your place, give yourself permission to truly value that which you love, even if you think society does not. And perhaps most importantly, remember that every dream you have may not be accomplished directly, but instead through ripples, through you and your family, from your mentors to you, from you to your friends. Thank you.